Blazin' Hot 91, the Blazin' Hot Morning Show. Every Wednesday, we take a pause for health healing in Hampton Roads. Now, today, we're talking with a millennial leader. He is definitely a positive changer, and he definitely is making his way with integrity, honesty, and dedication. He is a Norfolk State University alum of 2012, as well as in 2014, he was pretty much elected to the president of the Norfolk NAACP, and he became the youngest president in the United States for the NAACP. I welcome to the microphone Joe Dillard. Joe, good morning.
Good morning. Good morning. How you doing, brother? It seems like eons ago when I became the youngest. I certainly know now my bones, my mind is sharp. Uh-huh. My body's slowing down. So I know that's changed, but I'm grateful to share a few moments with you this morning and talk about some issues I think plaguing the country. Thanks for having me.
Oh, yeah, no problem at all. Now, Joe, let me just say, with so much going on in the world, from social and civil unrest, we got a virus that's pretty much running rampant on society, disproportionately affecting African-Americans. We have mailboxes being pretty much taken away. you see what I'm saying? To keep the ballots going down low. 45 is rallying and generating racial divide going on. In Dr. King's world, he basically, in his words, he basically said, America has given us a bad check, a check that has come back marked insufficient funds, but we refuse to believe that the Bank of Justice is bankrupt. Talk about that real quick, Joe. How do you feel about what is going on in America right now?
I like the phrase of the Bank of Justice is never going to be bankrupt. I think truth and justice always prevails. I often read, and I'm pretty sure you have too, brother. We read about the civil rights movement, what happened in the 50s and 60s, even the 30s when we're talking about lynchings and things of that magnitude, and always said, oh, that could never happen to us. And I think we're living in a time now that it is happening, but it's not happening in the same original manner. Some of the things that I've dealt with, it was a Norfolk State student one time a few years back, you might remember, who was attacked by a canine dog after leaving a party.
That's right.
You know, so you could take, that was 2015, you could take the date off and you wouldn't know it was 1920 or 2020. And I think the president right now, irregardless of what's going on with COVID, is using the campaign tactic of being divisive. I think a lot of people were upset that we had an African-American as the president, and this is the boomerang coming back. So a lot of those internal feelings that people, we already know as far as racism and things, those internal feelings are coming back out in a public manner, and they're masking it in support of Donald Trump. And it was pretty hard, I believe, whether to determine who those supporters were and who they weren't unless they had a hat on. But now with COVID and this pandemic going on, you could find out who supports who by asking them if they're taking the same medication that Donald Trump was taking. You can walk outside of Norfolk State right now, walk on the yard and see students with masks on, and then you can walk across the street to certain parts of Norfolk, even in Ocean View, and see that people will chastise you for even having a mask on. So I think the current president and administration is very divisive when it comes to things of equality, not just for African-Americans, but for a lot of people, a lot of minorities. And I think it's actually, if you look at the silver lining in between, I think it's a good thing, because now, brother, everyone is paying attention more so now than ever. If they were doing it through policy and things of that magnitude under the radar, I don't think people would be dialed in like they are now. And of course, with this pandemic, and the way me and you are just talking right now via phone rather than being in person, I think the way of life that we knew is definitely going to change in the future. And hopefully it changes under a new president as well.
Mm-hmm. So how do pretty much we guide ourselves through all of this? I know the NAACP have been the radicals who have been out actually protesting to make change. How do we do change?
That's a very good question, because I think I've done marches and protests for the longest. Before it even became a daily thing now, I was doing marches and protests. And I kind of pulled back from it now, because that was always the question, what's next? So like right now in Norfolk, right, we're doing these virtual town halls. We actually have one tomorrow. I started off with Kenny Alexander, the mayor of Norfolk, and Bobby Scott, the congressperson, to talk about social justice and equity, diversity and inclusion, citizen review boards over the police department. So So then we had a second town hall, right? And in that town hall, we had Delegate Joe Lindsay, Senator Linwood Lewis, and we had our Norfolk Police Chief, right, to talk about what can people do. So it's not just getting out and marching, but it's demanding certain things. Is it a citizen's reward? Is it more accountability and transparency in the police department and things of that magnitude? So, like, tomorrow, we have a conversation with Congresswoman Elaine Lawyer from the federal level.
Mm-hmm.
Now, Congresswoman Elaine Lawyer voted in favor or voted for a bill that would allow the president to have a little bit more control to send federal troops into localities. So we don't pick sides at the NAACP, oldest voter civil rights organization in the nation, right? So what we're trying to do is figure out, and she already gave an explanation, but we want to have the conversation of why would you support something like that, giving the president unilateral, you know, authority to do something that can definitely deter or impact our community in greater numbers. So when we go from there, brother, we're talking about deeper conversations of policy change. I know me and you talked about, I know we'll probably hit on what happened in Portsmouth. The stimulus checks. There's people walking around now thinking they're going to have a stimulus check at the end of the month. But if you don't understand policy and understand how Congress works, of how you can influence and change things, of if someone's been working since the pandemic happened on the front line and they're not getting hazard pay, but we shot unemployment up, there's certain things that we need to, address through that issue. So hopefully, I'm thinking definitely with the Norfolk NAACP, we're more so policy driven, you know. So if we can influence policy, things of old laws on the books, to make changing your everyday life that you might not understand, that's where we are from the Norfolk perspective.
Okay, talking about everything that is going on, we just mentioned Portsmouth. Let's break up our pretty much what is going on over in Portsmouth. You had a statue that was there for years sitting right up in the town square. You know, pretty much education was going on by the NAACP about what it was representing about the old whipping post that was even in Portsmouth that was right there. Pretty much the president gets arrested for being on city property, correct?
The president gets arrested for being on city property. I believe the vice president gets arrested. And the thing that bothered me the most of that entire situation, I believe the president and vice president were there as community members protesting.
Mm-hmm.
It wasn't a sanctioned, organized event by the NAACP. So in reality, if I'm at a march in Norfolk, and it's not an NAACP. I'm Joe Dillard. I'm representing Joe Dillard. They arrest them, then let them go. You know, so of course you're assuming it's just, and I don't want to talk about the city in a negative manner.
Right.
But the
right.
way they execute the law is very questionable to me, you know, because why was the president and vice president arrested when it wasn't an NAACP event? There were other people beyond the gate. They also had permission to be beyond the gate. And then 2 months later, brother, their felony charges brought up against these men, and of course, Senator Lucas, members of the community as well, community leaders in Portsmouth. And I just think it's bad pool, you know, and dealing in my daily life, I do government affairs. I believe when police chiefs or city managers dive into politics when they shouldn't have and just should do their job and represent the people, it becomes a slippery slope. And I believe the charges that were brought up against all of them are bogus, and it's going to bring a light on not just Portsmouth, but I think it's going to be a national light. I think Senator Lucas was on CNN this morning, or an article came out with Senator Lucas this morning. And I think it's you got to look at the silver lining, like I said earlier. The silver lining is going to show that the chief in Portsmouth might have abused her power. You know, she didn't go to the Commonwealth attorney and ask her to bring up these charges or allow her to recuse herself. So And as a Norfolk State graduate, and as a Norfolk boy, I tell you, man, Portsmouth does a great job of being Portsmouth. I can tell you that.
I got you. Pretty much, you know, we're talking about getting out and galvanizing now. Also, COVID brought out a lot of protesting that started to happen all over the city here in Norfolk, and standing up for rights. It pretty much started to become a big show as far as making sure that equality is being heard. What is the NAACP doing as far as equality of the citizens in Norfolk?
So I think our mission now, brother, is more so now. not to identify with a party, right, but identify with policy issues and subject matter. What you guys are doing right now, having me on the radio, having others on the radio, what Charlamagne the God is doing is saying, you know, before anything, especially as a minority and African-American, we got to realize that we're African-American. You know, we got to stop voting party first and start putting forth policies that are going to impact us in a greater magnitude. Should students be able to go to Norfolk State tuition free? You know, like, should students be allowed to get a refund check that's outstanding at the time, brother? But when you get out of school, you can't make the payments. So there's certain things when you're talking about equity that we need to address, and we're hoping to address through the Norfolk NAACP as far as policy discussions. So, like, the free tuition is a major issue for us. Of course, health care, things of that matter, too, plaguing our community. As a young man, I try to tune in and see what's going on, but I think it's alarming to me that African-American women are more subjective to complications and deaths and pregnancy than any other group, you know, and that should be addressed from the federal level. You know, I was reading yesterday that if you have an African-American doctor and you're pregnant, you're more likely to have that child and a healthy child, and three times more likely for your child to die if you have a white doctor. I don't think these things are happenstances. These are policy discussions, and when we talk about equity, we need to make sure not just, and I think people are more concerned about president, but all our elected officials are held accountable. Right now, I'm in Richmond, Virginia, as we're on this phone, and there are policy discussions talking about social justice, police reform, and the budget. If people aren't voting the right people in, these conversations that we're having today, those committees' assignments that you're talking about tomorrow wouldn't even be happening. So your vote is probably the most powerful thing. And I know people are like, oh, well, you know, Joe Biden this, Joe Biden that. I don't like Kamala Harris. That's fine. You don't like Donald Trump. Sit down and really understand what their policies are. And you always have to vote, because if you like them or not, their policies are going to impact you. So you need to go with whatever the policy is that greatest impacts what you're doing. And it always seems as though the African-Americans have greater policy equity and moving forward when it comes to more progressive leaders.
You just hit a nail right in the coffin right there when you said you got to go out and vote and be able to voice your opinion. I want you to talk directly to the citizens now and tell them to go out and vote, that their voice counts.
And this is me speaking freely, personally. So I serve on the Housing Authority in Norfolk, right? And we always talk about, across the country, gentrification. And that's a whole other conversation you can have with someone. But it's basically taking black communities or poor communities, gentrifying them, making rent so high that they can't come back, right? So we're doing this St. Paul's Quadrant plan now, which is Tidewater Gardens, which is near Norfolk State, Tidewater Gardens, Cary Park, and Young's Terrace, right? And as a board member on that housing authority, we're all trying, as board members, to prevent gentrification, right? But the political landscape and the importance of it, I see it like this, brother. If you think your vote doesn't count, there were 1,700 families in Tidewater Gardens, right? Last election, less than 100 of them voted, right? So the political implications of doing something to a community has no kickback, no pushback. Like, if I do this to you, if I tear down your neighborhood and put you out, you can't vote. You're not going to vote me out of office, because only 43 of you guys showed up to vote, right? So your vote is your voice. You can get up in front of council meetings, in front of state legislators, in front of federal officials, and make a two-minute speech within your two-minute time frame. And all they're going to do is go back, and if your voting population or your neighborhood isn't voting, you don't have a voice, truly. And when I say your voice is your vote, that's what I mean. So if Tidewater Gardens, brother, had 1,000 voters coming out, the whole conversation of them, what they're demanding and what they want, how they want a transparent process, will be totally different right now. You know, and it is still transparent. I won't take away from that. But they could do so much more. You could be so much more powerful when you say, this is what we want. And not only this is what we want, if you don't do what we want, you'll be voted out. I think tunes change quickly in that magnitude. I think a lot of people, especially minorities, look at elected officials and put them on this pedestal. But the truth is, they're elected officials because you and I put them there. So they're going to always be held accountable by the voters. And if you don't vote, how can you hold someone accountable and you didn't even vote? You know, and that's directly speaking to the people listening now. That's the most important thing. I don't care how you feel about the person running for president or local office. Take 15, 20 minutes and read their policy. And I can bet you $100 that one of their policies is going to impact your daily life. And it's either going to impact it for the better or impact it for the worse. And if you're telling me, brother, that you don't want to get out and vote to help fix your own impacts of your life, I think that's an oxymoron.
Mm-hmm. And well said, Joe. Well said. And we're talking with Joe Ballard and Health Healing and Hampton Roads. Joe, any final words that you want to leave?
As we talked about, I think everyone sees what's going on as far as politics more than ever. You see what's going on with the post office. I would just tell everyone to be engaged and to remain encouraged. Of course, we have COVID going on right now, so the impacts of that, whether are second to none. You know, we're in an ever-evolving market. You have a president that's telling you to take a drug that could possibly kill you. So I would tell everyone, just be informed, you know. And I think one thing, when I remember Mr. Rodney Jordan, when he was running for office, I think in 16, he came out with this thing called the Popsicle Index, right? And as a millennial, I understand it, but we never really used it, and that's talking to your neighbor. So because of social media, you know, I'm really more on social media. I couldn't tell you who my next-door neighbor is, and I've been living there for 3 years. That Popsicle Index is what our grandparents used to do, talking to your neighbor, getting to know your community. I would just encourage us, even during COVID right now, you know, while we have some downtime, if you're virtually working, get to know the members in your community, get to know your neighbors, and help out one another. You know, whether you might have bread, I might have water, and you don't have to horse trading. You know, I think those times are needed more than ever, of just netting the community and making sure that we're all standing as one and just take care of each other, because if we don't do it, nobody else will.
Mm-hmm. Well said, Joe. Thank you so much for coming on the show today. I really appreciate it, my brother. And welcome back to the, you know, to the campus via phone.
Thank you. You already know. Behold the green and gold.
There you go. Health Healing at Hampton Roads for today. Talking with Joe Dillard. Oh, my goodness. That was a great conversation. We got more music in store for you right here on Blazing Hot 91. We'll get through this together.